Chapter 3. The People of the Feud. Tikal smote on the bronze door with his clenched hand, and then turned sidewise, so that he could watch back along the hall.
"Men have been smitten down before this door when they thought they were safe," he said.
"Why don't they open the door?" asked Conan.
"They are looking at us through the eye," answered Tikal. "They are puzzled at the sight of you."
He lifted his voice and called,
"Open the door, Exelan! It is I, Tikal, with friends from the great world beyond the forest!"
"They will open," he assured his allies.
"They'd better do it in a hurry, then," said Conan grimly. "I hear something crawling along the floor beyond the hall."
Tikal went ashy again and attacked the door with his fists, screaming,
"Open, you fools! Open! The crawler is at our heels!"
Even as he beat and shouted, the great bronze door swung noiselessly back, revealing a heavy chain across the entrance, over which spearheads bristled and fierce countenances regarded them intently for an instant. Then the chain was dropped, and Tikal grasped the arms of his friends in a nervous frenzy and fairly dragged them over the threshold. A glance over his shoulder just as the door was closing showed Conan the long, dim vista of the hall, and dimly framed at the other end an ophidian shape that writhed slowly and painfully into view, flowing in a dull-hued length from a chamber door, its hideous blood-stained head wagging drunkenly. Then the closing door shut off the view. Inside the square chamber into which they had come, heavy bolts were drawn across the floor, and the chain locked into place. The door was made to stand the battering of a siege. Four men stood on guard, of the same lank-haired, dark-skinned breed as Tikal, with spears in their hands and swords at their hips. In the wall near the door there was a complicated contrivance of mirrors, which Conan guessed was the eye Tikal had mentioned, so arranged that a narrow, crystal-paned slot in the wall could be looked through from within without being discernible from without. The four guardsmen stared at the strangers with wonder, but asked no questions. Nor did Tikal vouchsafe any information. He moved with easy confidence now, as if he had shed his cloak of indecision and fear the instant he crossed the threshold.
"Come,"
he urged his newfound friends, but Conan glanced toward the door.
"What about those fellows who were following us? Won't they try to storm that door?"
Tikal shook his head.
"They know they cannot break down the door of the eagle. They will flee back to Xotalanc with their crawling fiend.
Come, I will take you to the rulers of Tecuhtli."
One of the four guards opened the door opposite the one by which they had entered, and they passed through into a hallway which, like most of the rooms on that level, was lighted by both the slot-like skylights and the clusters of winking fire-gems. But unlike the other rooms they had traversed, this hall showed evidences of occupation. Velvet tapestries adorned the glossy jade walls. Rich rugs were on the crimson floors, and the ivory seats, benches, and divans were littered with satin cushions. The hall ended in an ornate door before which stood no guard. Without ceremony, Tikal thrust the door open and ushered his friends into a broad chamber, where some 30 dark-skinned men and women, lounged on satin-covered couches, sprang up with exclamations of amazement. The men, all except one, were of the same type as Tikal, and the women were equally dark and strange-eyed, though not unbeautiful in a weird, dark way. They wore sandals, golden breastplates, and scanty silk skirts supported by gem-crusted girdles, and their black manes cut square at their naked shoulders were bound with silver circlets. On a wide ivory seat on a jade dais sat a man and a woman who differed subtly from the others. He was a giant, with an enormous sweep of breast and the shoulders of a bull. Unlike the others, he was bearded, with a thick blue-black beard which fell almost to his broad girdle. He wore a robe of purple silk which reflected changing sheens of color with his every movement, and one wide sleeve, drawn back to his elbow, revealed a forearm massive with corded muscles. The band which confined his blue-black locks was set with glittering jewels. The woman beside him sprang to her feet with a startled exclamation as the strangers entered, and her eyes, passing over Conan, fixed themselves with burning intensity on Valeria. She was tall and lithe, by far the most beautiful woman in the room. She was clad more scantily even than the others, for instead of a skirt, she wore merely a broad strip of gilt-worked purple cloth fastened to the middle of her girdle, which fell below her knees. Another strip at the back of her girdle completed that part of her costume, which she wore with a cynical indifference. Her breastplates and the circlet about her temples were adorned with gems. In her eyes alone, of all the dark-skinned people, there lurked no brooding gleam of madness. She spoke no word after her first exclamation. She stood tensely, her hands clenched, staring at Valeria. The man on the ivory seat had not risen. "Prince Olmec," spoke Tecatl, bowing low, with arms outspread and the palms of his hands turned upward. "I bring allies from the world beyond the forest. In the chamber of Tezcatli the Burning Skull slew Chicmec, my companion." "The Burning Skull!" It was a shuddering whisper of fear from the people of Tecatli. "Aye! Then came I, and found Chicmec lying with his throat cut. Before I could flee, the Burning Skull came upon me, and when I looked upon it, my blood became as ice, and the marrow of my bones melted. I could neither fight nor run. I could only await the stroke. Then came this white-skinned woman, and struck him down with her sword. And lo, it was only a dog of Xotalanc with white paint upon his skin, and the living skull of an ancient wizard upon his head. Now that skull lies in many pieces, and the dog who wore it is a dead man." An indescribably fierce exultation edged the last sentence, and was echoed in the low, savage exclamations from the crowding listeners. "But wait!" exclaimed Tecatl. "There is more! While I talked with the woman, four Xotalancs came upon us. One I slew. There is the stab in my thigh to prove how desperate was the fight. Two the woman killed. But we were hard-pressed when this man came into the fray and split the skull of the fourth. Aye! Five crimson nails there are to be driven into the Pillar of Vengeance." He pointed to a black column of ebony which stood behind the dais. Hundreds of red dots scarred its polished surface, the bright scarlet heads of heavy copper nails driven into the black wood. "Five red nails for five Xotalanca lives!" exulted Tecatl, and the horrible exultation in the faces of the listeners made them inhuman.
"Who are these people?" asked Olmec,
and his voice was like the low, deep rumble of a distant bull. None of the people of Xotalanc spoke loudly. It was as if they had absorbed into their souls the silence of the empty halls and deserted chambers.
"I am Conan, a Cimmerian," answered the barbarian briefly. "This woman is Valeria of the Red Brotherhood, an Aquilonian pirate. We are deserters from an army on the Darfar border, far to the north, and are trying to reach the coast."
The woman on the dais spoke loudly, her words tripping in her haste.
"You can never reach the coast. There is no escape from Xotalanc. You will spend the rest of your lives in the city."
"What do you mean?"
growled Conan, clapping his hand to his hilt and stepping about so as to face both the dais and the rest of the room.
"Are you telling us we're prisoners?"
"She did not mean that," interposed Olmec. "We are your friends. We would not restrain you against your will. But I fear other circumstances will make it impossible for you to leave Xotalanc."
His eyes flickered to Valeria, and he lowered them quickly.
"This woman is Tascala," he said. "She is a princess of Tecatli. But let food and drink be brought our guests. Doubtless they are hungry and weary from their long travels."
He indicated an ivory table, and after an exchange of glances, The adventurers seated themselves. The Cimmerian was suspicious. His fierce blue eyes roved about the chamber, and he kept his sword close to his hand. But an invitation to eat and drink never found him backward. His eyes kept wandering to Tascala, but the princess had eyes only for his white-skinned companion. Tecadl, who had bound a strip of silk about his wounded thigh, placed himself at the table to attend to the wants of his friends, seeming to consider it a privilege and honor to see after their needs. He inspected the food and drink the others brought in gold vessels and dishes, and tasted each before he placed it before his guests. While they ate, Olmec sat in silence on his ivory seat, watching them from under his broad black brows. Tascala sat beside him, chin cupped in her hands, and her elbows resting on her knees. Her dark, enigmatic eyes, burning with a mysterious light, never left Valeria's supple figure. Behind her seat, a sullen, handsome girl waved an ostrich-plume fan with a slow rhythm. The food was fruit of an exotic kind, unfamiliar to the wanderers, but very palatable, and the drink was a light crimson wine that carried a heady tang.
"You have come from afar," said Olmec at last. "I have read the books of our fathers. Aquilonia lies beyond the lands of the Stygians and the Shemites, beyond Argos and Zingara, and Cimmeria lies beyond Aquilonia." "We have each a roving foot," answered Conan carelessly. "How you wand through the forest is a wonder to me," quoth Olmec. "In bygone days 1,000 fighting men scarcely were able to carve a road through its perils. We encountered a bench-legged monstrosity about the size of a mastodon," said Conan casually, holding out his wine goblet, which Tecutl filled with evident pleasure. "But when we'd killed it, we had no further trouble." The wine vessel slipped from Tecutl's hand to crash on the floor. His dusky skin went ashy. Olmec started to his feet. An image of stunned amazement and a low gasp of awe or terror breathed up from the others. Some slipped to their knees as if their legs would not support them. Only Tascala seemed not to have heard. Conan glared about him bewilderedly.
"What's the matter? What are you gaping about?"
You slew the dragon god?"
"God? I killed a dragon. Why not? It was trying to gobble us up."
"But dragons are immortal," exclaimed Olmec.
"They slay each other." "But no man ever killed a dragon. The 1,000 fighting men of our ancestors who fought their way to Zacotl could not prevail against them. Their swords broke like twigs against their scales. If your ancestors had thought to dip their spears in the poisonous juice of Durketa's apples," quoth Conan with his mouth full, "and jab them in the eyes or mouth or somewhere like that, they'd have seen that dragons are no more immortal than any other chunk of beef. The carcass lies at the edge of the trees, just within the forest. If you don't believe me, go and look for yourself."
Olmec shook his head, not in disbelief, but in wonder.
"It was because of the dragons that our ancestors took refuge in Zacotl," said he. "They dared not pass through the plain and plunge into the forest beyond. Scores of them were seized and devoured by the monsters before they could reach the city."
"Then your ancestors didn't build Zacotl?" asked Valeria.
"It was ancient when they first came into the land. How long it had stood there, not even its degenerate inhabitants knew."
"Your people came from Lake Zuad?" questioned Conan.
"Aye. More than half a century ago, a tribe of the Talazet lands rebelled against the Stygian king, and being defeated in battle, fled southward. For many weeks they wandered over grasslands, desert, and hills, and at last they came into the great forest, 1,000 fighting men with their women and children. It was in this forest that the dragons fell upon them, and they tore many to pieces. So the people fled in a frenzy of fear before them, and at last came into the plain, and saw the city of Zacotl in the midst of it. They camped before the city, not daring to leave the plain,
for the night was made hideous with the noise of the battling monsters through the forest. They made war incessantly upon one another. Yet they came not into the plain. The people of the city shut their gates and shot arrows at our people from the walls. The Tlazitlans were imprisoned on the plain, as if the ring of the forest had been a great wall, for to venture into the woods would have been madness. That night there came secretly to their camp a slave from the city, one of their own blood, who, with a band of exploring soldiers, had wandered into the forest long before, when he was a young man. The dragons had devoured all his companions, but he had been taken into the city to dwell in servitude. His name was Tolkemec. A flame lighted the dark eyes at mention of the name, and some of the people muttered obscenely and spat. He promised to open the gates to the warriors. He asked only that all captives taken be delivered into his hands. At dawn he opened the gates. The warriors swarmed in, and the halls of Zacatl ran red. Only a few hundred folk dwelt there, decaying remnants of a once great race. Tolkemec said that they came from the east, long ago, from old Kosala, when the ancestors of those who now dwell in Kosala came up from the south and drove forth the original inhabitants of the land. They wandered far westward and finally found this forest-girdled plain, inhabited then by a tribe of black people. These they enslaved and set to building a city. From the hills to the east they brought jade and marble and lapis lazuli, and gold and silver and copper. Herds of elephants provided them with ivory. When their city was completed, they slew all the black slaves, and their magicians made a terrible magic to guard the city. For by their necromantic arts they recreated the dragons which had once dwelt in this lost land, and whose monstrous bones they found in the forest. Those bones they clothed in flesh and life, and the living beasts walked the earth as they walked it when time was young. But the wizards wove a spell that kept them in the forest, and they came not into the plain. So for many centuries the people of Zacatl dwelt in their city, cultivating the fertile plain, until their wise men learned how to grow fruit within the city, fruit which is not planted in soil, but obtains its nourishment out of the air. And then they let the irrigation ditches run dry, and dwelt more and more in luxurious sloth, until decay seized them. They were a dying race when our ancestors broke through the forest and came into the plain. Their wizards had died, and the people had forgot their ancient necromancy. They could fight neither by sorcery nor by sword. Well, our fathers slew the people of Zacatl, all except 100 which were given living into the hands of Tolkemec, who had been their slave. And for many days and nights the halls re-echoed to their screams under the agony of his tortures. So the Tlazitlans dwelt here, for a while in peace, ruled by the brothers Tecoltli and Xotalanc, and by Tolkemec. Tolkemec took a girl of the tribe to wife, and because he had opened the gates, and because he knew of many of the arts of the Zacotlans, he shared the rule of the tribe with the brothers who had led the rebellion in the fight. For a few years, then, they dwelt at peace within the city, doing little but eating, drinking, making love, and raising children. There was no necessity to till the plain, for Tolkemec taught them how to cultivate the air-devouring fruits. Besides, the slaying of the Zacotlans broke the spell that held the dragons in the forest, and they came nightly and bellowed about the gates of the city. The plain ran red with the blood of their eternal warfare, and it was then that— He bit his tongue in the midst of the sentence, then presently continued, but Valeria and Conan felt that he had checked an admission he had considered unwise. 5 years they dwelt in peace. Then Olmec's eyes rested briefly on the silent woman at his side. Xotalanc took a woman to wife, a woman whom both Tecoltli and old Tolkemec desired. In his madness, Tecoltli stole her from her husband. Aye, she went willingly enough. Tolkemec, to spite Xotalanc, aided Tecoltli. Xotalanc demanded that she be given back to him,
and the council of the tribe decided that the matter should be left to the woman. She chose to remain with Tecuhtli. In wrath, Xotalanc sought to take her back by force, and the retainers of the brothers came to blows in the great hall. There was much bitterness. Blood was shed on both sides. The quarrel became a feud, the feud an open war. From the welter, three factions emerged: Tecuhtli, Xotalanc, and Tolkemec. Already, in the days of peace, they had divided the city between them. Tecuhtli dwelt in the western quarter of the city, Xotalanc in the eastern, and Tolkemec with his family by the southern gate. Anger and resentment and jealousy blossomed into bloodshed and rape and murder. Once the sword was drawn, there was no turning back. For blood called for blood, and vengeance followed, swift on the heels of atrocity. Tecuhtli fought with Xotalanc, and Tolkemec aided first one and then the other, betraying each faction as it fitted his purposes. Tecuhtli and his people withdrew into the quarter of the western gate where we now sit. Xucotl is built in the shape of an oval. Tecuhtli, which took its name from its prince, occupies the western end of the oval. The people blocked up all doors connecting the quarter with the rest of the city, except one on each floor, which could be defended easily. They went into the pits below the city and built a wall cutting off the western end of the catacombs, where lie the bodies of the ancient Xucotlans, and of those the Tlazitlan slain in the feud. They dwelt as in a besieged castle, making sorties and forays on their enemies. The people of Xotalanc likewise fortified the eastern quarter of the city, and Tolkemec did likewise with the quarter by the southern gate. The central part of the city was left bare and uninhabited. Those empty walls and chambers became a battleground and a region of brooding terror. Tolkemec warred on both clans. He was a fiend in the form of a human, worse than Xotalanc. He knew many secrets of the city he never told the others. From the crypts of the catacombs he plundered the dead of their grisly secrets, secrets of ancient kings and wizards, long forgotten by the degenerate Xucotlans our ancestors slew. But all his magic did not aid him the night we of the Tecuhtli stormed his castle and butchered all his people. Tolkemec we tortured for many days. His voice sank into a caressing slur, and a faraway look grew in his eyes, as if he looked back over the years to a scene which caused him intense pleasure.
Aye, we kept the life in him until he screamed for death as for a bride. At last we took him living from the torture chamber, and cast him into a dungeon for the rats to gnaw as he died. From that dungeon somehow he managed to escape, and dragged himself into the catacombs. There, without doubt, he died. For the only way out of the catacombs beneath Tecuhtli is through Tecuhtli, and he never emerged by that way. His bones were never found, and the superstitious among our people swear that his ghost haunts the crypts to this day, wailing among the bones of the dead. 12 years ago we butchered the people of Tolkemec, but the feud raged on between Tecuhtli and Xotalanc, as it will rage until the last man, the last woman, is dead. It was 50 years ago that Tecuhtli stole the wife of Xotalanc. Half a century the feud has endured. I was born in it. All in this chamber, except Tascala, were born in it. We expect to die in it. We are a dying race, even as were those Xucotlans our ancestors slew. When the feud began, there were hundreds in each faction. Now we of Tecuhtli number only these you see before you, and the men who guard the four doors. 40 in all. How many Xotalancas there are, we do not know, but I doubt if there are much more numerous than we. For 15 years no children have been born to us, and we have seen none among the Xotalancas. We are dying. But before we die, we will slay as many of the men of Xotalanc as the gods permit.
And with his weird eyes blazing, Olmec spoke long of that grisly feud, fought out in silent chambers and dim halls under the blaze of the green fire jewels, on floors smoldering with the flames of hell and splashed with deeper crimson from severed veins. In that long butchery, a whole generation had perished. Xotalanc was dead, long ago, slain in a grim battle on an ivory stair. Tecuhtli was dead, flayed alive by the maddened Xotalancas who had captured him. Without emotion, Olmec told of hideous battles fought in black corridors, of ambushes on twisted stairs and red butcheries. With a redder, more abysmal gleam in his deep, dark eyes, he told of men and women flayed alive, mutilated and dismembered, of captives howling under tortures so ghastly that even the barbarous Cimmerian grunted. No wonder Tecuhtli had trembled with the terror of capture. Yet he had gone forth to slay if he could, driven by that was stronger than his fear. Olmec spoke further, of dark and mysterious matters, of black magic and wizardry conjured out of the black night of the catacombs, of weird creatures invoked out of the darkness for horrible allies. In these things the Xotalancas had the advantage, for it was in the eastern catacombs where lay the bones of the greatest wizards of the ancient Zucotlans, with their immemorial secrets. Valeria listened with morbid fascination. The feud had become a terrible elemental power, driving the people of Zucotl inexorably on to doom and extinction. It filled their whole lives. They were born in it, and they expected to die in it. They never left their barricaded castle, except to steal forth into the halls of silence that lay between the opposing fortresses, to slay and be slain. Sometimes the raiders returned with frantic captives, or with grim tokens of victory in fight. Sometimes they did not return at all, or returned only as severed limbs cast down before the bolted bronze doors. It was a ghastly, unreal nightmare existence these people lived, shut off from the rest of the world, caught together like rabid rats in the same trap, butchering one another through the years, crouching and creeping through the sunless corridors to maim and torture and murder. While Olmec talked, Valeria felt the blazing eyes of Tascala fixed upon her. The princess seemed not to hear what Olmec was saying. Her expression, as he narrated victories or defeats, did not mirror the wild rage or fiendish exultation that alternated on the faces of the other Tecuhtli. The feud that was an obsession to her clansmen seemed meaningless to her. Valeria found her indifferent callousness more repugnant than Olmec's naked ferocity.
"And we can never leave the city," said Olmec. "For 50 years no one has left it except those..."
Again he checked himself.
"Even without the peril of the dragons," he continued, "we who were born and raised in the city would not dare leave it. We have never set foot outside the walls. We are not accustomed to the open sky and the naked sun. No, we were born in Zucotl, and in Zucotl we shall die."
"Well," said Conan, "with your leave, we'll take our chances with the dragons. This feud is none of our business. If you'll show us to the west gate, we'll be on our way."
Tascala's hands clenched, and she started to speak, but Olmec interrupted her.
"It is nearly nightfall. If you wander forth into the plain by night, you will certainly fall prey to the dragons.
We crossed it last night, and slept in the open without seeing any,"
returned Conan. Tascala smiled mirthlessly.
"You dare not leave Zucotl."
Conan glared at her with instinctive antagonism. She was not looking at him, but at the woman opposite him.
"I think they dare," stated Olmec. "But look you, Conan and Valeria, the gods must have sent you to us, to cast victory into the laps of the Tecuhtli. You are professional fighters. Why not fight for us? We have wealth in abundance. Precious jewels are as common in Zucotl as cobblestones are in the cities of the world. Some the Zucotlans brought with them from Kosala. Some, like the firestones, they found in the hills to the east.
Aid us to wipe out the Xotalancas, and we will give you all the jewels you can carry.
And will you help us destroy the dragons? Asked Valeria. With bows and poisoned arrows, 30 men could slay all the dragons in the forest.
Aye, replied Olmec promptly. We have forgotten the use of the bow in years of hand-to-hand fighting. But we can learn again.
What do you say? Valeria inquired of Conan.
We're both penniless vagabonds, he grinned heartily. I'd as soon kill Xotalancas as anybody.
Then you agree,
exclaimed Olmec, while Tecatl fairly hugged himself with delight.
Aye. And now suppose you show us chambers where we can sleep, so we can be fresh tomorrow for the beginning of the slaying.
Olmec nodded and waved a hand, and Tecatl and a woman led the adventurers into a corridor which led through a door off to the left of the jade dais. A glance back showed Valeria Olmec sitting on his throne, chin on knotted fist, staring after them. His eyes burned with a weird flame. Tascala leaned back in her seat, whispering to the sullen-faced maid Yasala, who leaned over her shoulder, her ear to the princess's moving lips. The hallway was not so broad as most they had traversed, but it was long. Presently the woman halted, opened a door, and drew aside for Valeria to enter.
"Wait a minute," growled Conan. "Where do I sleep?"
Tecatl pointed to a chamber across the hallway, but one door farther down. Conan hesitated, and seemed inclined to raise an objection, but Valeria smiled spitefully at him, and shut the door in his face. He muttered something uncomplimentary about women in general, and strode off down the corridor after Tecatl. In the ornate chamber where he was to sleep, he glanced up at the slot-like skylights. Some were wide enough to admit the body of a slender man, supposing the glass were broken.
"Why don't the Xotalancas come over the roofs and shatter those skylights?" he asked.
"They cannot be broken," answered Tecatl. "Besides, the roofs would be hard to clamber over. They are mostly spires and domes and steep ridges."
He volunteered more information about the castle of Tecatl. Like the rest of the city, it contained 4 stories, or tiers of chambers, with towers jutting up from the roof. Each tier was named. Indeed, the people of Xucatl had a name for each chamber, hall, and stair in the city, as people of more normal cities designate streets and quarters. In Tecatl, the floors were named the Eagle's Tier, the Ape's Tier, the Tiger's Tier, and the Serpent's Tier. In the order as enumerated, the Eagle's Tier being the highest, or 4th floor.
"Who is Tascala?" asked Conan. "Olmec's wife?"
Tecatl shuddered and glanced furtively about him before answering.
"No, she is Tascala. She was the wife of Xotalanc, the woman Tecatl stole to start the feud."
"What are you talking about?" demanded Conan. "That woman is beautiful and young. Are you trying to tell me that she was a wife 50 years ago?"
"Aye, I swear it. She was a full-grown woman when the Tlazitlans journeyed from Lake Zuad. It was because the king of Stygia desired her for a concubine that Xotalanc and his brother rebelled and fled into the wilderness. She is a witch who possesses the secret of perpetual youth."
"What's that?"
asked Conan.
Tecatl
shuddered again.
"Ask me not. I dare not speak. It is too grisly, even for Xucatl."
And touching his finger to his lips, he glided from the chamber.